Let's talk about clay dreams. Welcome to the Film Threat Podcast. I am Chris Gore, and I am a fan of claymation. Will Vinton, as a kid, was a huge inspiration for me. I even made, yes, my own clay animated films, little Super 8 movies. When I was a kid with a Super 8 camera, 310 XL, Will Vinton was the inspiration. And I saw Closed Mondays is probably the movie that was the one that inspired me the most, because it showed that claymation didn't have to be cartoony or for kids. It was incredibly profound. It's also an Oscar-winning short animated film. The director of a new documentary is here. Mark Evans is here. Clay Dream is the documentary about Will Vinton that is premiering at the Tribeca Film Festival. Mark, how's it going, man?
Good, Chris. How you doing? I think we need to see some of those early films. Did any survive that you made?
Oh, a lot of them. Yeah, they're all like transferred to video. I'm sure I could upload a file and you can see these clay animated films, but it was really Closed Mondays was the one that really inspired me, because I saw it as part of this. I found it on YouTube. It's called The Animation Celebration. Mm-hmm. And it included actually two Will Vinton shorts. There's the one, I forget the name of it, but it's the band on the mountaintop. The mountaintop explodes.
Mountain Music. That was his second film.
Oh God. Brilliant. And this documentary is epic.
Oh, thanks, man.
It is epic. I don't know how many years you worked on it, but it had to be years in the making, because it spans decades. Will Vinton's career, which I thought I knew a lot of stuff and really did not. Tell me, how did you get started with this? How did you discover it? And I need to ask specifically about one of the framing devices you use in the documentary is this legal proceeding that is incredible. And the fact that all this footage exists, and that is a thread throughout. Once you get to that thread runs throughout. Yeah. How did you find that footage? How long did you spend? And what made you want to, because this is the second time we've spoken. I mean, your last documentary was also a decade spanning, a very dramatic personal story. But tell me what got you into Clay Dream with Will Vinton's story.
Yeah. So this goes back to like 2015. Was when I first, I guess, uncovered the story for myself. I was finishing my previous film that you mentioned, The Glamour and the Squalor, and just looking for new projects, what might be the next project, and stumbled upon an article that was kind of detailed the rise and fall of Will Vinton Studios. And when I read this, it totally felt like a movie, first and foremost. And I knew of Will, I knew his name, I knew his mustache. And I knew some of the characters, like the California Raisins and the Domino's Noid. So I had that. There was the nostalgia factor, but then just this article really kind of blew me away. And I thought, again, this feels like a movie. So I reached out to Will, and I got an email back. I reached out, I think, the day that I read this article, and got an email back pretty quickly from his assistant, who later I figured out was his wife, saying he'll meet with you, but he's not really interested in doing a movie. And so I'm like, all right, well, at least it's an opportunity. It's a way in. And so we had coffee, like a 3-hour coffee, and totally hit it off. I thought it went great. And then the next day he said, it was great meeting you, but I don't think I'm interested in doing the movie. So, I thought, oh, that's too bad, but we'll stay in touch. So we stayed in touch for about 6 months, and finally he, after several other meetings, he came around and said, let's do this thing. And from that moment, it was great to work with him. He was totally open, with his own time, and then access to all of his archival materials, introductions to people that, I needed introductions to. So it was really great. But, you know, there's a lot. There's a ton. There's a lot to the story, and then there was a lot of. It was just a gift to have access to his archives, and then there was a handful of people that worked at the studio that documented a lot of things. So to be able to get their archives as well, and then you mentioned, you know, the legal proceeding, the deposition that came from Will, but not for like 2 years into the project. I knew nothing about it. I knew that was part of the story, but I didn't know that I would have footage like that to tell that story. And one day I was up down in his basement, just going through materials. And he said, did I ever give you the deposition? Like, what do you mean? Like transcripts? And he said, no, we shot it. So he handed me this box full of beta tapes that we ended up transferring. And I remember getting those back and thinking like, okay, like this is a layer that I knew it was going to be part of the story, but I didn't know we would actually have the material to tell that story. So it was pretty amazing.
And not only that, this deposition is not just filmed like, you know, straight out. Like, we've seen deposition tapes before, and it's usually just a person kind of almost feels like an interrogation. This was produced. I mean, it looks like there was effort putting into, you know, camera changing shots, and just it was almost like the person who shot the deposition thought they were going to create some dramatic story.
Well, it was professionally shot. And I didn't know this until later, until like last year. I had a box of some of these documents from the legal proceedings, and there was a piece of paper in Will's handwriting that was talking about maybe we make a documentary about what happened. And he was like, contact Michael Moore, ? And so Will never told me that, but there must've been some idea that he would maybe, you know, have somebody make this into a movie, which is funny because again, when I first met with him, he was like, I don't really want to do anything like that. But at some point he certainly did.
Well, I don't think that Michael Moore is exactly the right fit to make this. He's more politically makes more politically driven docs, but this one really just brought me back to those memories of, I mean, that's what's so cool about clay animation. Like, I'm not someone who, I can't draw, but almost anyone can make a clay animated movie. Yeah. I mean, it really is. I mean, the fact that it's tactile, the fact that it's, if you're using digital tools, I mean, it's instant, right? You can just see the results of your work, but you must have been a fan going into this. So it had to be just as a fan, because you clearly went through an archive. Obviously we only saw a portion of what was in that archive, but as a fan, what was it like to just devour all things Will Vinton in that studio going through his archives?
Yeah, it was amazing. And, you know, and I wasn't somebody that grew up like, and I've heard from several people, many people, kind of your story, like, yeah, I made these little, you know, films. And it is so accessible because of what you said, like you can create something pretty immediately and see your work. You don't have to wait too long. And that's, I think, what really inspired him early on. He started doing this in college, his architecture programs. He was like making his work. He would show off everything in clay, and then he would shoot it and make his final presentation in film. But for me, I was, you know, a fan of the characters and the shows that he had made. And so it was an amazing process. Like every new discovery, a lot of the stuff too, like, I mean, going through boxes and like pulling out like, oh, here's the Noid. Like this is the Noid that was used in the commercials, and then Raisins and the Mark Twain character, like those are all preserved. And then ultimately like coming across, getting connected with the Academy, and they have a lot of his early short films preserved in HD 2K and everywhere else, even in Will's own collection, they weren't that high quality. So they, and we got new scans. There was a lot of things that was on the old film reels that we got scanned 4K. So that's the other really cool thing about this is a lot of this work is now being shown in the highest quality that anybody's ever seen it.
I'm hoping that your documentary will also, you know, prompt some sort of re-release of his work. I, you know, the Mark Twain movie I was aware of, but I never saw. And your breakdown of how it, like, they put all this effort into it, it was released, it bombed and failed. I haven't seen it. Will that ever get released? And I assume you've seen the whole thing.
Yeah, and actually that may be on Netflix. That actually is the one that kind of did, but not with a bunch of promotion. But they did restore it. I think it's on Netflix, or at least it was. But that, you know, as he describes it, it's like the zenith of clay animation, because they put all their techniques of everything that they had done up to that point into this one film, and then it bombed mostly. I mean, artistically, it is incredible. I think it is really the highlight of showing off Will's work in the studio because of all the different things that it does artistically. But it was marketed towards kids, and it wasn't made for kids. The kids that did see it, a lot of them are still scarred, I think, decades later from this one scene, the mysterious stranger. Will kind of is famous in the smaller group, not for everything else that he did, but for creating this mysterious stranger segment. But yeah, I mean, the work is just, there was nothing else like it at the time. And it definitely paved the way for a lot of, you know, that kind of work that is still being done today at a high level from, you know, certainly Leica, there's a direct connection, but even Starburns Industries, you know, who's a co-producer on the film, they created Rick and Morty, and they did Anomalisa, which was Academy Award nominated. They, you know, anybody doing stop motion today can look back and see that Wilvin paved the way for that.
Yeah, the stop motion community it seems very connected. Every time you talk to someone in stop motion, they all know each other.
Yeah.
Oddly enough. And I am going to Netflix to check out and see if the Mark Twain movie is on. Yeah,
it's been a while. It was on there like 2 years ago. So I haven't checked though for a while.
Wow, man. You know, I was unaware that Leica owns its history to Will Vinton. It's kind of that company evolved into Leica, and Leica really has come into its own. I mean, so much of the work that they've done has just been just remarkable, right? I mean, I would say that they're the only real competitor to Pixar in the sense that there's such a focus on story. Coraline is probably one of my favorites. I mean, that film really holds up. And I do actually, I would say that like, it does bother me a little bit that we think just because something's animation, it has to be for kids.
Yeah.
I don't think that that's the case. I think animation is a way to tell a story. It doesn't always have to be for kids. And I think that Dark Material is something that actually kids respond to. I think at least when I was a kid, those were the things that I really liked and responded to. And I guess I prefer the way that, say, the Japanese look at anime is that's just a way to tell a story, and there is.
Yeah, it's not a genre. It gets called a genre, but it's not. It's just it's like a method or a style of telling a story, and it can be all kinds of different stories. So it shouldn't be seen as a genre, and like all credit to Leica. I mean, I love their films. We watch all the Leica films in our household, and you know, I do wish that they would kind of acknowledge the actual history of when the studio started, and you know, the reason a lot of people didn't know this that. It came out of Will Vinton Studios is because that's not how they tell it. You know, it was kind of a brand new studio that just kind of came out of nowhere. But I mean, the people that were working there were all Will Vinton Studio, you know, people. But yeah, I hope they keep making films and keep making great films because they do it at the highest level.
Now, Tribeca is an in-person film festival. Is that right? I know they're doing some outdoor screening.
Partly, yeah. I think the bulk of the festival is still taking place virtually. So for instance, for Claydream, it's available starting on Sunday to anybody in the US. So it's pretty cool that, like, you know, generally, if you want to see a film at Tribeca, you've got to be in New York, in the neighborhood of Tribeca. Mm-hmm. But this will be released Sunday, June 13th, and anybody in the US can buy, not even a pass to the whole festival, you can buy a pass just to the individual film. So it's pretty cool. I'm hoping to get it exposed to a larger audience because of that. And you know, certainly honored to be a part of Tribeca with, you know, such a great festival and such a great lineup.
I really like this model of, I hope that some film festivals continue this, that if you're unable to attend a festival, you can buy effectively, you know, a premium access to their streaming service. That's all or most of the movies playing at a festival for a window of time for 2 weeks. Slam Dance did it. I'm glad that Tribeca is doing it.
Yeah. I think that it seems to me that will be something here to stay, just as long as, you know, for the festivals that it makes financial sense and all that. Hopefully that's one good thing that will come out of this tough time for the festivals is that they kind of, you know, stumbled upon this model that might be beneficial moving forward.
And are you seeking distribution? Have you locked in your distribution?
We haven't locked it yet. It's just, we're in the middle of that right now. So, fingers crossed that it'll find a nice home and be, you know, available wider. And, so we'll see. We'll see how that happens. We'll see.
Well, what Netflix, happens. Netflix is a pretty good home.
We'll see. Yeah, that'd be great.
one of the other threads that ran through the film that I thought was really, you know, profound and was Will Vinton's sort of disconnectedness. He was so connected with the work, he had difficulty, it seems, connecting with people. And he grew, you know, through the course of his life. And you have footage kind of showing this pivot. What was it like knowing the man? I mean, you had a 3-hour coffee with him, and then he said, you know, not going to make the documentary with you. Obviously he changed his mind, but did you get that glimpse into, you know, seeing him now, this sort of evolved person after all that time?
Yeah, that's a great question. First of all, I always enjoyed the time that I spent with Will. I found him to be very down to earth, normal guy, you know, not some like eccentric, crazy artist, just easy to hang around with. And, you know, my kind of the best memories that I have aren't going to be where we shot things together. It's going to be going over to his house, you know, without the camera, and him taking me on a boat trip out on the Willamette River. Like, so that was always a lot of fun, you know, getting beer with him or something like that. That said, I probably didn't get to personally know him on a deeper level in a similar way that a lot of people share. That's really hard to, and he is, it's not just that he's guarded. It's the fact that I think he really struggled with showing his own emotion, and for things that maybe were painful or even, you know, deemed like negative or something that maybe like, yeah, you know, would hurt him or whatever. He didn't really want to go there ever. So, you know, I think I got some of that out of him finally in the film. But what he wanted to do was always just focus on the positive. And I think that's very admirable, but also potentially a flaw or, you know, a negative thing, because if you're doing that, then you're not addressing some things that maybe you should be addressing. And I think ultimately that happened in several ways, you know, even down to when he was sick, you know, good close friends didn't even know that he was sick. Knew nothing about that. And I always really enjoyed my time with him, and do think he really came around from what, you know, everything that I was told in a lot of ways, you know, before the end of it. And like I said, just a real good guy and a normal guy. He's from McMinnville, Oregon, and I think that small town of him is that's who he is. And I think, like I said, he wanted to focus on positive things. He didn't ever want to address anything that was negative. And getting him to talk about Bob Gardner, you know, his first partner, like that was always really hard for him. I probably had to ask him 45 times during our interviews. I would keep circling back to try to get him to really share how he felt. I think he finally did, you know, but one time, I got it one time, because he would have rather just not talked about that.
What's his reaction to the film now that it's, I mean, I assume he's seen it.
Well, he, you know, he passed away and
Yeah. I didn't know that. I'm so sorry. So sorry.
So he got to see 15 minutes or so of not of the final film, of something early, but it was enough to know that he saw enough of the film to know, like, cool, it's going to be good. It's in good hands. He could see the work that was going into it. So I'm very grateful that he had that opportunity to at least know that, like, okay, it's going to be solid.
Well, it's an amazing film. It's an inspiration. It's really amazing to see the legacy of Leica. I just thought Leica came out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And to see that I watched a lot of the DVDs of the Leica stuff and they're behind the scenes. It almost seems like they took the Will Vinton process and they kind of just took it the next step.
Yeah. I mean, it was the same people for the most part, you know?
Right.
Like, the same people that had their hands on the work, you know, the clay or the puppets, whatever. But now they had all that experience, but then they also had amazing resources as well too, in a way that, you know, Vinton Studios didn't really have. So they were able to take that to the next level, and that's, I'm glad they did, because we've got great art, you know, great stories and great films because of that.
Well, Mark Evans, congratulations on the film Clay Dream. I know we're going to see it on something. There are 900 streaming services now. I'm not sure if you've been counting. But
I hope all 900 want it and we can, you know, have a big bidding war.
Yeah, no, this is, look, I mean, it's really hard to tell that kind of story that spans decades. And, you know, you really knocked out of the park. So thanks again and congratulations on the film.
I appreciate that. Thanks, Chris.